Hey, welcome to UK Wildcrafts. So if you're into foraging or hiking or wild camping, or you spend any amount of time in the forest, then I think it's a really good idea to get to learn the trees around you, because it can make the woodland feel a lot more like home if you can just go out, identify trees and see if there's any uses for you, like edibility or making fire or shelter. So first of all, behind me is an English oak, Quercus robur, which is a very common tree in the UK. It can grow anywhere up to nearly 40 metres, although it actually, in its old age, can get shorter, so it makes it less likely to be knocked over by the wind, and it will prolong its lifespan. The bark of the oak is a greyish-brown colour, and it has very deep ridges. And the fruit of the oak is the acorn, which sits in the egg cup base. The leaves are fairly easy to recognise. They've got undulating lobes. And their image is used on the logos of both the Woodland Trust and the National Trust. The two most common species of oak that you're likely to find in the UK are this one here, the English oak, Quercus robur, and the sessile oak, Quercus petraea. So the way that we tell that this one is an English oak is we look how the leaves are attached to the stem. So this one here has very short leaf stems attaching it to the main branch, and the English oak acorns will have a long stem, whereas sessile oak is the complete opposite. The leaves will have a long stem and the acorns will have a short stem. So acorns are edible, but they're usually far too bitter. They need to be processed to remove the tannins. So they need to be crushed, soaked in water, and then the tannins leached out that way. And that needs to be processed several times to make them edible. So I don't think the amount of effort is worth the reward. Also, the timber of oak is used a lot in building because it's very strong. Hazel is a very common native tree, usually one of the smaller trees found in the woodland. It's got quite distinctive long straight stems that all come upright from the base. Sometimes it has one main central trunk with lots of smaller stems coming from it. Sometimes it's like this, where they're all fairly small. So the bark is usually light grey or a bit brown. And on the larger, older stems, the bark is often peeling away. The leaves grow alternately down the stem. The leaves are rounded with a point at the end, and they are doubly toothed. So you've got the larger serrations, and in between those you've got smaller teeth. The leaves are fairly soft to the touch, and that's because they've got a downy fur underneath. And also the leaf stems are furry as well. In winter you'll see the distinctive male catkins. The fruit of the hazel tree is of course the hazelnut, which has to be in my top 5 wild edibles. They usually mature in early September, but you have to be very quick to beat the squirrels to them. The hazel branches or stems are very useful in crafting because it's very pliable. Very bendy. They can be used in weaving baskets. The ones that are a little bit thicker, like that sort of width, are good in building fences, wattle fencing, I use that for,
and also for if you've got growing tomatoes, you can use them as canes for growing the tomatoes up.
This is common ash, Fraxinus excelsior, which sounds like something out of a Harry Potter book. It's one of the most common trees in the UK. It can grow up to 35 metres. The bark on younger specimens can be quite smooth. On older ones, it's quite ridged, and you get a network of crisscross patterns on the bark. In the winter, it's quite easy to tell by the twigs have the buds on, which are quite a dark black. And it flowers before the leaves open. The leaves of the ash tree usually appear quite late in spring. They're usually one of the last trees to come into leaf. The leaves are serrated. And they're compound leaves, which means many leaflets per stem. There's usually between 9 and 13 per stem. And they grow in opposing pairs. And then one terminal leaf. The fruit of the ash tree are these ash keys. They are edible, but only when very young. The greener the better. And they do need to be pickled. You'll find absolutely loads this time of year in May on ash trees. So ash is quite a useful hardwood, and many crafters use it for handles of making tools, especially axes. When you find dead ash, there's a very good chance that you'll find a fungi on there. It's like a little black dome. That's called King Alfred's cake. Daldinia concentrica. It grows almost exclusively on dead ash. And you'll see the concentric rings when you cut it in half. Now this fungi is really good for fire lighting. If you take a spark onto the fungi, once it's dried, then it's really easy to get a fire going. And you can also carry an ember, just keep blowing on it, and you can carry the ember with you when you're changing camp, so you can easily set up a new fire. Silver birch has to be one of the easiest trees to ID in the winter because of its distinctive bark, which is silver with black striations running horizontally. As the tree gets older, it develops diamond-shaped fissures in the bark. And as it gets older still, the base of the tree gets darker brown and rugged. Silver birch has both male and female flowers, or catkins. The male ones in groups of two or four, and they're long yellow catkins that hang from the tree. And then female ones are smaller and green and stand upright. And if you look around, they usually form in around April time. And here are the ones that have died and fallen off the tree. They'll be all around. I'm in May now, so they're not on the tree anymore, but all around the base of the tree, there's loads of them. The leaves of the silver birch are small, fairly triangular shaped, and toothed. Birch bark is really useful for fire lighting because it contains oils which are highly flammable. Someone here has been cutting it off the tree, which I generally don't do because it can damage the tree. It's actually much easier to collect it from dead, fallen bits of birch, and I think it works better as well. So yeah, don't go cutting it off the tree. You can also collect birch sap from birch trees in early spring, which gives you a nice healthy drink. It's a bit like mineral water, but tastes a bit sweeter. You can often find also birch polypore fungi growing on dead or dying silver birch trees, which is a very useful mushroom to find. You can use it as a plaster if you peel off the pores on the underneath of the mushroom. You can also grind it down and use it for fire lighting, and it's also used for sharpening blades as well once it's been sliced and dried. So if you're into bushcraft, silver birch is a very useful tree to know. This is horse chestnut, a large non-native tree that can grow to about 40 metres and will often live for about 300 years. The bark, when it's young, is usually quite smooth and greyish. When they get older, the bark goes darker brown and a bit scaly. It flowers in May. The flowers have four or five white petals that go pink at the base. The fruit of the horse chestnut are conkers, and they develop inside a green spiky case in autumn. So the buds are brownish red and they're sticky. The leaves are palmate. They usually have 5 to 7 leaves that radiate out from the central stem, and the leaves are toothed. So conkers aren't edible, but you can use them if you cut them up and dry them. You can use them as a laundry detergent, and the leaves as well you can also use. If you crush up the leaves and add a bit of water, you can use them as a hand soap, and that's because they contain saponins, which is like a natural form of soap. Beech is a large native species. Can grow above 40 metres. Its bark is smooth and grey and can develop shallow fissures with age. If you see carvings on the bark, there's a good chance that you've got a beech tree, because it's got nice smooth bark. People like to carve their names on it. The fruit of the beech tree are beech nuts, also known as beech mast. And it's another good way of identifying the tree. If you look at the base of the tree and dig around in the leaf litter, you'll find the discarded shells or casings of the beech nuts. So beech leaves have a rounded oval shape, and the margins, the edges of the leaves, are wavy, and when they're young they have really fine hairs, but as they get older they lose those hairs and go a darker green. When they're this age, when they're still a little bit translucent, they're nice and edible, and they make a good substitute for lettuce. Another way to tell it's a beech leaf is it has usually around 9 pairs of veins that grow diagonally down the leaf. The budding arrangement of the beech are alternate, so you'll get leaves on one side of the branch, then the other, and then the other alternating up the stem. Beech trees like to grow on free draining soil, so if you're in an area that has a lot of beech trees like this here, then there's a good chance that you're in a chalk or limestone area.
Thanks for watching UK Wildcrafts. If you haven't already, you can subscribe here.